Hi, I'm Femi OK, and you're in the stream. It's 6 months to Election Day in the United States when one of the most powerful political positions in the world will be decided. It's a long, arduous election process that's being closely watched within the US, but also from outside. So today we'll speak to Al Jazeera correspondents with insights into how the world is watching. You're in for a fascinating program. No pressure, colleagues. With me, my bestie colleague, Malika Bilal, digital producer, looking into what is the world saying about the US election.
Oh my gosh, Fanny, there are so many interesting perspectives, clearly from around the world. We're getting all of them coming in online. Take a look at what people are telling us. So there are a few things that they're finding fascinating about the U.S. election process, like whether there's a media bias in coverage of Donald Trump, and what a two-party system and corporate money do to the democratic process. So much to dive into today. You can join the conversation with hashtag AJStream.
So the 2016 U.S. election cycle began almost 2 years ago. It's been chock full of debates and caucuses and primaries, all a part of a unique electoral process. Now, after two terms of a Democratic presidency, the Republicans are trying to win back the White House. Over time, their candidates have dwindled from more than a dozen to just one, and that's the presumptive nominee, business tycoon Donald Trump. The Democrats are still waiting to decide on their nominee, the former Secretary of State Hillary Clinton or Senator Bernie Sanders. So to help us break things down, with us right here on our set, we have Al Jazeera White House correspondent Paddy Cohen. In London, Al Jazeera senior correspondent Barnaby Phillips. In Abuja, Nigeria, West Africa correspondent Yvonne Ndege. And in Doha, Hoda Abdulhamid, Al Jazeera's roving senior correspondent in the Middle East. So it's good to have you here, everybody. Patty, what the what?
So you can't say that.
Yeah.
Okay, we have to put this in perspective because people are hearing these Trump comments, like, for example, today.
But what Trump comments?
Well, today he was talking about the debt, and he says the U.S. can't default on its debt because it prints its own money.
Yeah.
And all of the economists quickly explained that, no, that's not the case. And then over the weekend he said, we're going to lower the national debt because we're going to ask people to sell us our debt back at a fraction of the price. And the response is, of course, nobody's going to do that. And he said, well, what if they needed the money? What if China suddenly needed $1.8 billion? So people are looking at these comments that seem not grounded in any semblance of reality. Yeah. And they're saying, how can he be the presumptive nominee? First, I'm not convinced that the Republican establishment won't strip it from him, but this is the perspective I want the world to have. We have a very strange system. It's a primary system. 10.6 million Republicans have voted for Donald Trump. Would you like to know how many people, Americans, voted in the last presidential election, 2012?
Go ahead, tell us.
129 million.
Okay.
So 10 million Republicans in a primary, 129 million in a race that not a lot of people are jazzed
about. So you're trying
to tell
the world, don't panic?
No, I'm not saying that that's not time to panic, but I do want to say that...
panic, but here are the stats.
Yeah, no, so the country has not voted for Donald Trump. And if you look at the possibility that they would, where he stands right now, he has unfavorability ratings like no person in modern political history. He would be almost impossible for him to actually win the election. Just to give you a sense, 67% of voters right now across the country think of him unfavorably.
So he's really unpopular. Hold tight with that thought. Malika.
So, Barnaby, picking up on what Patty just said, I want to read you this tweet from Krista. She's in the UK. She says, I go to university with people from all around the world. They're all very worried about us, meaning Americans, and not getting nuked. And she goes on to say, I kept telling everyone that Trump would never be the nominee, and now I look like an idiot. You could see the little gif there, the picture there, kind of a face palm. People didn't believe that this could happen, but it did happen. She's speaking from the UK. What are you hearing people saying?
I think it's fair to say that there is widespread dismay and apprehension at the prospect of Donald Trump becoming president. And people here did not think that he would ever reach the position of being presumptive nominee. I mean, just to give you a couple of examples, you know, we have a Conservative Party government here. It's traditionally quite close to the Republicans. Several months ago, David Cameron, our prime minister, was asked what he thought about Donald Trump's plan to ban Muslims from entering the United States. And he said, I quote, it's stupid, divisive, and wrong. These are extraordinary words for a British politician to use about someone who could become the president of the United States. Last week, David Cameron was asked whether he would apologize to Donald Trump now that Mr. Trump is in this apparently much stronger political position. And he said, no, I won't apologize. Another little anecdote. this city that I'm living in, that I'm talking to you from, London, my home city, has just elected a Muslim mayor in the same week that Donald Trump has become the presumptive nominee of the Republicans. So you can see a diplomatic car crash on the horizon, undoubtedly, if he were to win the election. I know Patty has just given us some very good reasons why it might not happen.
Let me show you something, Hodder. Come up close to my laptop and come close to your screen here. So these are still the candidates are still in the running. Any one of them could be president of the United States. Take us through, from your perspective, what the region that you work in thinks about each of them. We've got Bernie Sanders. What kind of favorability rating does he have? What do people think about him?
Well, they don't know him very much, but they obviously reacted when he talked about the Israeli-Palestinian conflict and then when he also talked about the Iran deal, when he sort of said that Washington and Israel would be at odds over these two issues if he were to become president. So there's a feeling that he has different ideas. Yeah. They're not expecting much from Hillary Clinton. For them, Hillary Clinton is someone who is from the establishment, someone they know, someone who has visited this region many, many times. So they did not really expect much from her. What they did follow very closely is obviously Donald Trump, all the rhetoric coming out from Donald Trump. And I think that tweet Malika read earlier is something people here joke about all the time. People would tell you, oh gosh, if Donald Trump becomes president, what's going to happen to us? Are we going to get, as that tweet said, nuked? Are the Muslims are all going to get killed? Everybody's going to be banned from the U.S. There's all this sort of worry. They're joking about it for the moment, but it's certainly something that is becoming more and more serious in the conversation here. As I said, it started as a joke, but now people are really worried.
Let me show you something, Yvonne. There's a comedian who is now in the United States, and he's called Trevor Noah, but he's a really well-known South African comedian as well. And he did some analysis on Donald Trump, and he did a little compare and contrast. I'm going to play you the little section and ask you what you think about it. So here's The Daily Show with Trevor Noah.
What I'm trying to say is Donald Trump is presidential. He just happens to be running on the wrong continent. In fact, once you realize that Trump is basically the perfect African president, you start to notice the similarities everywhere, like the level of self-regard.
I say not in a braggadocious way. I've made billions and billions of dollars.
I made a tremendous amount of money. I'm really rich.
I have a great temperament.
They love me anyway. I don't have to do this.
I've done an amazing job.
I was born with a certain intellect. God helped me by giving me a certain brain.
I bet that's the one time that God's like, I don't need the praise. It's cool. That's you. That's you. I'm cool. Now, is that extraordinary level of bragging presidential? Well, let's ask a man who actually was president. Idi Amin, former president and best president of Uganda.
The people likes me very much. I am very popular. I am very powerful. I am the one who has got the money. I have got a very good brain.
Oh, the humor coming thick and fast there, Yvonne. But does Trevor Noah have a point? Is there something about that particular candidate that might resonate in different parts of the continent?
Very good question. Well, firstly, everybody's just still trying to deal with the excitement of having Barack Obama, whose dad obviously is from Kenya, as president of the United States. And most people here don't understand why that needs to end. They do feel that he has a special place for Africa in his heart, as it were. And the prospect of a Trump presidency is dividing opinion. There are those who feel it's the worst thing that could possibly happen in the world, simply because some of the controversial, to put it mildly, statements that he has made. Obviously, we've touched on his statement about temporarily banning Muslims from the United States. Obviously, countries like Nigeria and many in West Africa have high population levels, Muslim population levels. But on the other hand, talking to some people today, you know, there is a feeling that he is the right man for the job amongst some people, that he's a tough guy, that he talks straight, and he addresses the experiences and the feelings of ordinary, regular American people. There's also, I think I'm detecting a sort of a gender bias, you could say, because there are those who also feel that actually the office of President of the United States is not a place for women, and that you know, somebody like Donald Trump would be more suited simply because he is a man. But I think overall, if I had to kind of say, you know, on what side people are swaying to, I would say that the legacy of the Democratic Party in Africa is much more relevant and stronger. People do feel that Barack Obama, that Hillary Clinton, if she does clinch the nomination for the Democratic Party, will be more interested in what's going on in Africa. Obviously, there have been initiatives like the Power Africa initiative that Obama started to bring electricity to Africa. Obviously, Hillary Clinton has experience as Secretary of State in the United States and has traveled to Africa. But when you look at Trump and what he has to say about Africa, well, there's very little to go on. So I would say that, in general, most people are veering towards supporting a Democratic candidate in this race. But opinions, like I say, still slightly divided.
You know, Yvonne, that's interesting you said that. I want to read a tweet that we got out of Nigeria. Patty, I'll throw this over to you. This is Shitu. He says, Trump isn't seen as a leader here in Nigeria and in Africa, he posits to say, because of his quote-unquote racist speeches. We prefer Hillary Clinton. So the two of them, even Bernie Sanders, do they have policies that they've announced for Nigeria, for other countries in Africa? Are there things that are tangible to hold on to here?
This is an election where they're couldn't be further apart. We're hearing Republicans say we're going to get rid of all foreign aid, although it makes up like this much of the federal budget. But that's just, the American people don't realize that. So, and then I think when we look at a Bernie Sanders, Hillary Clinton, very much continue the policies, if not expand on them, from Barack Obama. I think we need to point out, because the world doesn't know this, Donald Trump led the birther movement. Do you all, have you ever explained what the birther movement is?
I don't think we ever did a show on it, but it's the
Barack Obama wasn't born here.
Birth certificate. There was a whole campaign that
he's not really
American.
He's not American.
He's Kenyan.
He's an African. Yeah, he's African.
And probably a Muslim.
Yep.
And he's neither.
No, he is neither. But Donald Trump led that effort. We cannot underestimate. So basically, I think right now the world is going, explain to me how this happened. How is Donald Trump the only one left standing on the Republican stage? The world's not alone. The Republican establishment is wondering that as well. We need to have a broader look at, there is some racism in that, President Barack Obama has had a fairly successful presidency from a lot of people's perspective, and he has been demonized so much so on the left or on the right for anything successful he's done, that there is an element of racism that you're hearing in these Trump rallies. But again, this is the minority of people. But he has tapped into a very real anger, and if you travel the country, you know why. I was just in Flint, Michigan. For 2 years, the government let the children of Flint drink lead-tainted water, and they didn't tell anyone. Mm-hmm. There is a sense, and this has long-term health repercussions. This is in the United States of America. Americans are angry, and I don't want to bore you with statistics, but people feel as if they're running on a treadmill. If you look at the average hourly wage from 1964 in adjusted dollars, it hasn't moved. People are basically running in place. Wall Street, we had the crisis. No one on Wall Street went to prison. Well, like one guy did. And millions of Americans lost their homes.
So that anger translates into
anybody
Donald Trump becoming a Republican nominee for president.
Barack Obama was going to change everything. Remember, just remember the moment that he was elected.
Yeah.
The entire world was like, I mean, he talked about we're going to mend the world and calm the rising seas. The expectations were almost godlike. And so people believed in Obama, and all of these they've seen, and he'll admit this, is more polarization. The government doesn't work. It doesn't work for the people that put them in office. They feel powerless, they're angry, and it's easy to believe that somebody else can come in and fix it. Maybe the anti-Obama, which would be Donald Trump.
All right, so you've given us some context. I'm just curious here, Barnaby, how much foreign policy is getting over to you from the election campaign in the United States? Are you hearing foreign policy? Are you hearing, I see what they would do as president of the United States?
Yeah, you know, I am, Femi, but I follow these things very closely. It's
you're
part
nerd
of my
like
life,
I am, right?
I'm even married to an American, for better or for worse.
Right.
So
taking
so
your homework seriously.
But I think what Donald Trump says about foreign policy is causing alarm, definitely, because it seems so unpredictable. His ideas on NATO, his ideas on Vladimir Putin, his ideas on ripping up the Iran nuclear deal. All of that seems very hazardous, and we don't quite know what to expect. What Hillary Clinton says is something that, you know, European political elites, excuse me, like Hodder was saying in the Middle East,
yeah,
are much more familiar with. Of course, we've seen Hillary Clinton in London many, many times. We've seen her in Paris. We know what she thinks about all sorts of things, you know, whether Britain should leave the European Union, whether Vladimir Putin is a threat, what should be done about the migration crisis. Bernie Sanders, a bit of an unknown quantity, definitely attractive to the European left on, for example, some of the big trade issues. You know, there's a big trade deal talk going on between the EU and America. Attractive to British ears when he talks about healthcare. You know, we in Britain think Americans are a bit mad and why don't they have a proper healthcare system? And he's proposing one. But the realists amongst us say, well, President Obama tried something relatively modest on healthcare by European standards, and he had such a torrid time in Congress for that. We don't really believe that Bernie Sanders can deliver his otherwise somewhat attractive to European ears dream.
Sure. Let me play a little bit of Bernie Sanders. This is him talking about Syria in January, January the 17th. Hodder, I'd love you to respond, but have a listen to the clip first of all.
Our first priority must be the destruction of ISIS. Our second priority must be getting rid of Assad through some political settlement, working with Iran, working with Russia. But the immediate task is to bring all interests together who want to destroy ISIS, including Russia, including Iran, including our Muslim allies, to make that the major priority.
Wish we had a split screen because Hodder was doing this. You were scowling. What's going on behind that scowl, Hodder?
No, I was listening because actually, he's probably the one who gave the most complete vision on how to solve the Syrian crisis. Mostly you hear about, Donald Trump said it, about destroying ISIS, going after ISIS. Well, that is not enough, certainly, to solve the problem there. Bashar al-Assad is as big as a problem for Syrians than ISIS itself. So it goes hand in hand. And he was probably, those were the most realistic words I've heard. Otherwise, really, when you're sitting in this part of the world and you hear what's going on and you hear, you were asking earlier if there was any foreign policy coming out or is it reaching us, it's reaching us but just in headlines, nothing that makes complete sense, nothing that seems that is possible. And a lot of people in this region would tell you, oh, we always hear many things during the electoral campaign, and then when they come to power, well, it's a whole different story. So certainly this Trump character, where you never know what he's going to say, yeah, or you know all too well his feelings at this point for many here in the in this region. He said it loud and clear that he's anti-Muslim. In some sense, he's put himself in a lot of trouble if he becomes president and he wants to fight ISIS, as he promised his people in America. Well, then he's going to have to deal with Arab Muslim leaders. Top of that list is Saudi Arabia. How are Saudi officials going to at least openly deal with Donald Trump after how much he insulted the Muslims? It's a very complicated situation here.
Well, not just that, I want to point out one of the things Trump said is that he's going to go after terrorists, he's going to kill the...
Absolutely, Yvonne. We're just finishing up with Patty and I'll come right back to you.
That he would kill the children and spouses of terrorists. And we quickly saw military officials in the United States say, well, nobody would follow those orders because it's an unlawful order and we can defy the commander-in-chief in that case. So I know people across the globe are saying, are these are extreme comments. Even by U.S. standards, these are extremely, extremely extreme comments, basically.
So, Yvonne, go ahead.
For me, like the good journalist that I am, I decided to do a bit of research prior to this show into what the main candidates had actually said about Africa, and there was just such little information out there. And I think that's one of the challenges for people who are trying to follow what's going on in the United States. There is very little clear policy direction, and I think one of the things that, you know, I would love to hear from Patty and many people who are following the election in Africa is, what will foreign policy be towards this continent? Like I said earlier, there was a feeling that Obama had a soft spot for Africa simply because his dad was from Kenya. Hillary Clinton has the background as Secretary of State and has traveled to the continent. what will the two candidates, main candidates who clinch their nominations, actually do in this region? There is a feeling here that somebody like Trump would be better at tackling Boko Haram, for example, which has been behind, obviously, lots of killing and destruction in the northeast of Nigeria. He's the kind of guy who would send in American Marines to eliminate Boko Haram. And there is a bit of a feeling that maybe the other side, the Democrats, might be a bit soft. So I think we would sort of love to hear a little bit more about if there is any clear foreign policy direction from the main candidates. Does Africa even feature as an issue for the next president of the United States?
Well, I actually want to return that to a question to you. Do people feel as if Obama has done enough when it comes to fighting Boko Haram, or do they feel like he could do more?
Well, they do. I think they feel that, you know, he's the president who will care most in the history of American politics for Africa because of the history and the link to Kenya, that when the Chibok girls, the girls who were kidnapped from the Northeast, were taken, that there was a concerted effort by Washington to try and find out what was going on. There have been other initiatives like the Power Africa initiative that he started, which was the bringing electricity to the continent. So yes, I mean, people feel that he's left a legacy on Africa, maybe not as much as he could have done, but they don't think it's because he didn't want to, Patty. They think it's because he was stopped by Congress and other interest groups. And their worry now is that with him, the son of an African man, leaving office, will Africa now fall off the agenda and off the priority list, if you like, of the next president of the United States?
Well,
and I'm not sure what the answer is to that question, if there is an answer.
Well, actually, Boko Haram, when the girls were taken, the president did order in a very small contingent, and it went unnoticed, basically, but he pulled them out fairly soon after. So there's not a huge U.S. presence now looking for those girls. On Donald Trump's foreign policy, we have no idea.
Yeah.
He gave a speech. He said, I'm going to get rid of ISIL. I'm going to do it so fast, but I can't
tell
you.
I think the answer to Yvonne is no idea. How could we possibly know? Barnaby?
Yeah, I just had a question for Yvonne. I was in Abuja 16 years ago when Bill Clinton visited as president, and he was loved. I think Yvonne can correct me, but I think they even named the highway leading from the airport into the city is called Bill Clinton Boulevard. And does some of that love for Bill Clinton still exist, and does it shine on Hillary Clinton a little bit?
I think it does. We do have quite a number of streets named after former American presidents and senior congressmen. And yes, people do make the comparison, wrongly or rightly, between Nigeria and the United States. People feel it's a big and important country, America and Nigeria. And yes, I think that Hillary will still be able to cash in, if you like, on some of the legacy that was left by her husband, particularly in the area of vaccinations and immunizations of children, particularly in the northern region, from diseases like polio and the sort of
Yvonne,
financial.
We're just wrapping up the show, so hold tight for a moment, and I'm going to take you to the post show. So hold tight for a minute, Yvonne. So, this is not very journalistic, but I'm going to ask you, in 6 months' time, do you think, what gender will the president be? Let me just put it that way.
It'll be a woman. It'll be Hillary Clinton. Unless...
Barnaby?
Caveat, wait.
No caveat.
It's going to be Hillary. I'll bet my house on it.
Don't bet your house.
Hoda, what gender will the president of America be?
It's going to be Hillary.
Very interesting. Okay, Hoda, Yvonne, Barnaby, Patty, we won't tie you to that, but we will take you to the online post show, stream.aljazeera.com. See you there. Hello again. We are looking at how the world views the US elections through our correspondents' eyes from around the world. Malika, where do you want to take us next?
Since we're hearing from people all around the world, I want to go just a little bit south of the US border to Mexico. We got a few things in from there. This is Miguel, who tweets in, most Mexicans see his rhetoric, he's talking about Trump here, as unfair and unrepresentative of Mexico. This is why many Mexicans at home and abroad have staged demonstrations or public-facing acts that set themselves as a counterpoint to Trump's demagoguery. He says that those are his words there. Another person actually sent us a comment, something similar along those same lines. This is a video comment we got from a journalist in Mexico City, Esteban. Have a listen to what he said.
Mexico is solely focused on Trump, on Donald Trump, that is. They want to know whether the wall will actually be built, whether we'll pay for it, and what we'll do against it, because the Mexican government has so far failed to stand up to Donald Trump and his inflammatory rhetoric. So that's a big problem here. They don't care about anything else in the election.
So, Patty, you visibly reacted to this comment we got from Esteban. This wall has been the talk of a lot of people. Your views are pretty visible in your face, but what do you think?
I mean, he can't build a wall. He can't take, he says, I'm going to pay for it by taking money that Mexicans who live here send back to Mexico. You can't do, I mean, the president, President Barack Obama, sort of laughed at that. He was, what are you going to case out Western Union? It's illegal. You cannot do it. There's no logic and there's no fact checking in the U.S. So people in Mexico and everywhere else think he could actually build a wall. He can't build a wall. Wherever I'm supposed to look, he can't build a wall. It's not going to happen.
But, talk about fact-checking.
Well, what's really interesting?
Yeah, go ahead, Hoda.
I was just, that tweet, and those same comments you hear in this part of the world, obviously not about the wall, but, everybody's focused on Trump, of course, with all what he says. And the idea is very similar. People here are saying, well, we're being insulted on a daily basis. No one is doing anything. And they're not worried about a wall, but they're also worried about what could happen if Trump comes to power. And if he becomes president, if all the Muslims and all the Arabs of the world are going to be punished and are going to be labeled as terrorists. Some will tell you that he's already done that, even though he never said it, but some would tell you that they feel that he has already insulted everyone and he already views all Arabs as terrorists, if not, or second-class human beings.
Well, and let's point out the reason why, a lot of reasons why Trump is where he is because the Republican Party is so completely broken and fractured. There were 16 presidential candidates, and he got so much free publicity. Every speech he gave, the cable networks in America took from beginning to end. They let him say whatever he wanted, and nobody ever fact-checked him. I said this at the end of the show, and you said a caveat to whether or not
Hillary. What's the caveat? Go on.
I'm not convinced the Republicans are going to give the nomination to Trump. They have rules committees at the convention.
What do you know that we don't?
There's a back door where the establishment is put in the rules committee at the convention. Yeah. They can make up, like South Carolina, your delegates don't count. Iowa, your delegates don't count.
They can just make up new rules.
Well, they're basically saying these delegates don't count for X reason. They'd have to have a reason, but it doesn't have to be that great of a reason. Strip it from him. He doesn't get it on the first vote. They try and find someone else to take his place. If not, they will put a third-party candidate up. Mark my words, they have to. If Trump is the presidential nominee for the Republican Party, the Republicans will lose the Senate, maybe the House, dozens of governorships, local elections. Republicans, 4 out of 10, say they just won't vote or they'll vote for Hillary. It will be such a landslide, not just in the presidential race, they will lose power in Washington.
I'm trying not to. It's really hard not to respond. We are trained not to have any political opinions, and I'm just trying not to say anything now.
It's not having a political opinion. It's the truth. They can't put Trump up. They know that. I mean, his unfavorable.
I'm just gonna do my emoji face.
His unfavorables are he's unelectable. He can't. Everyone's like, well, he'll switch his opinion. He'll start asking presidential. He'll say, I didn't really mean it about the wall. We're not talking about Roosevelt's time where no one knew when he was in a wheelchair. The man's on videotape. You cannot change your opinions. And he showed no ability or discipline to be able to do it. He came out and said, I'm going to be so presidential, you're going to be bored, I'm going to be so presidential. And he came out and started calling people liars. And I mean, he doesn't have it in him. If he does, we haven't seen it.
Why are we laughing? This is awful.
So it's not
a comedy.
Some of the facts that Patty just raised that explain some of the media coverage we're seeing from around the world. Barnaby, Europe's a big place, but these are two very different sentiments. two very different countries, same sentiment. Jarno on Facebook says, here in Finland, Trump is often portrayed as a person who lives out of hate and populism. His lies are also often highlighted, and it seems to us that he is a symbol for Western decay. Kind of strong words there. Another comment on Facebook also, this is Irma. She says, he's often seen like our Dutch Geert Wilders, a far-right party leader, a lot of screaming against outsiders, but no real effort to make anything better. It's a shame for humanity. So you see these two views there in different countries, but kind of similar view. But then I wonder, because she mentioned Geert Wilders, we have seen the rise of far-right parties who may embody some of the sentiment that Trump supporters are also espousing. What do you make of that in Europe?
Yes, I mean, I don't know if I'd call Trump far right, but I would say what he has in common with people like Geert Wilders in the Netherlands, or with a party like UKIP, that's the UK Independence Party in Britain that wants to take Britain out of the European Union, or paradoxically on the left with a party like Syriza in government in Greece, is that they all reflect a dissatisfaction with the old political elite, a sense of disillusionment, a sense of being cheated, a sense that people in the West aren't as affluent and life is not going to be as good for our children as it was for our parents, that things are going down. And so they, all of them, cash in on that sentiment, if you like. And Donald Trump has done that par excellence, undoubtedly.
Paddy, I know you wanted to try and revisit Yvonne's question.
Yes.
Go for it.
Okay, so basically when it comes to what would Trump do, is he an interventionist? He said he's going to get rid of ISIL, but not go and start any new wars. We have no idea what his foreign policy would be. It would be likely that he would try and cut foreign aid in the budget and get out of NATO. So those are the things we know. As far as Sanders, he'd be less likely to go after Boko Haram. He really very much would be afraid of any additional conflicts, I believe. Clinton is thought of as the more hawkish, probably the most hawkish of the Democratic candidates that we've seen in a while, even more so. We know her record as Secretary of State. She was often the one in the room pushing for the military to do more, to do more. And there will be that people will be like, well, can a woman be tough enough to start a war? And so that will be hanging over her head. And we can't pretend that it won't be, because that's what you've always heard when you hear women can't be leaders. They wouldn't send people into war because, you know, that's a bad thing, apparently. Does that answer your question, sweetheart?
Yeah, and people do think that, you know, Trump will be tougher because he's a man. And also, one thing that I didn't raise earlier was the fight against corruption in Africa. There were some comments in an apparent foreign policy speech that he made, not sure whether it was quite accurate, about dealing with corruption. And there is a feeling here that he would be better at dealing with African leaders, public officials who are involved in the misappropriation of public funds, that he appeals to the local people, the ordinary people, and that resonates very strongly here, that he defends ordinary working people. And that's why there are quite a number of Nigerians who do hope that he will clinch the Republican nomination and go on to be the next president.
One of the things you said, Patty, was pretty interesting, which was about fact-checking in the US and the lack of it. How is it working in this environment as a journalist that's talking to the rest of the world, trying to explain what's happening in the US? And part of the reason this is happening, I have to say, is the way it's been covered. It's I don't want to put air quotes in it, but the coverage rather than the journalism that's happening around this election race.
Just to give you a sense of, I was talking off record, or just talking to one of the cable channel correspondents, and he was saying how, I can't believe Trump's winning, and this is such a shock, and being covering his rallies, it's like you're in a war zone. And I just thought, like, you did this. Mm. You put him on. We had this president of CBS News, the network of Edward R. Murrow, say, Trump sure is bad for America. He might be bad for America, but he's sure been great for CBS. Because people are tuning in, because it's seen as a sideshow, not a presidential election. Now, what we've seen in the last few days, now that Trump is the presumptive nominee, the media is starting to turn on him. They're starting to actually ask questions, and he is melting down. He had three flip-flops on his tax policy in 24 hours. So imagine what's going to happen. And that's why I say wait until July, wait until we get to the convention.
You know something and you're not telling us.
I just know that they can't do it. They will not, they will, the Republican Party will be, and maybe, you know, there's a branch of the Republican establishment that says let's get behind Trump. And then there's the Paul Ryan, Speaker of the House, who came out and said, gosh, I hope I don't have to vote for a third party candidate. I mean, he could have put that in neon, like, please God, don't let it be Trump.
Interesting. Ooh, I could have you and keep you all day, but I know it's evening where you are, and I'm not going to do that. But we have to do this again. It's been really interesting. Paddy, I know you've got something in your back pocket there you're not telling us about. Meanwhile, let me just check in with Malika. Malika, how's this been going online, this conversation?
I'll wrap us up with this tweet from, his handle is dead serious, so you have to believe him. He says, Obama was seen as progress by most of the world, and this election, he says, will, I'll say could, cause a lack of confidence in America's intentions globally. So we'll see.
Stay tuned.
So Patty and Barnaby, Yvonne and Hoda, it's been great having you all here. It's nice to chat to your colleagues as your job. And hopefully we'll do it all again soon. Take care, everybody. Thanks for being on the stream.